Hey everyone, welcome. So yes, we have a different platform for the rest of our series since Life Team's taking a well-deserved break, but we're not because we want to continue conversations with you. So we're taking on a very critical series the next 4 weeks, and this is called At the Table. And At the Table is a Life Night series on racism. And I know we've heard a lot everywhere, but we're excited that we're gonna be able to talk and listen to each other in our small community, which it's been so great to get to know you during this Zoom calls. So I think this is a really good platform. I wish we could do it in person, but I think the fact that we're a small group is going to be amazing. So I just wanna give you a little bit of ground rules, and I'll remind you every time, because let's not do what the world is doing, right? Let's do this the way St. Bernard's youth group knows how to do things, right? Like love each other and be there for each other. So there are four guidelines that I want to present to you that we should remember every time we meet and talk about this topic. So one is when we share, let's talk about ourselves. Let's not talk about somebody else's experience. Let's not talk about what you've heard. But when you are comfortable to share, let's always use the I feel or my experience is. It's not our opinion, it's what we've gone through. Like I might be able to share some of my own experiences as a Mexican American, and it's based on what I've experienced, not what others have experienced. So that's first ground, not what my mother said, my grandma, my whatever. So that's one. The second one, let's all listen to understand and speak with charity. Meaning, let's all be open to what people are saying and let's be charitable. Let's be patient and let's be understanding. Our group is known to be really respectful, and I know and hope and expect that that will remain through this series. The third one is let's respect each other's experiences. Sometimes we don't understand how some other people feel because we haven't lived it ourselves. That doesn't make it less important. So again, we've been so good throughout the years about listening to each other. So let's respect each other's experiences, whether we understand it, agree with it or not. Okay, it's our own story. And the last one, let's always assume good intentions. Again, St. Bernard's Youth Group, you are always been so gracious to each other. So let's remain that. If we say we're not here to attack or to judge, let's always remember that what we are all saying is coming from a good intention. And every time we get together, let's invite the Spirit, so we know how to communicate and how to be brothers and sisters to each other and accompany each other through this time. Okay? All right, so let's get to it.
Surprise. I bet you're expecting to see another one of those fancy smancy Life Team videos with all those pretty young people. Well, sorry to disappoint you, but you got the old white guy today. And the reason I say old white guy is because for the next 4 weeks, we're going to talk about a subject that's kind of tough for some people. And the topic is going to be racial inequality and racism. Now you may be thinking, well, okay, if that's what we're going to talk about, an old white guy, is he the person really that should be leading this particular discussion? And I can understand that, but by the same token, I think that because I am this old white guy, I've got many years of experience seeing and experiencing this from obviously a white person's perspective, so that we can talk about it. sometimes when we start to talk about this, especially in the Christian environment, in the Catholic environment, we can be a little trite. And we can say, well, we're all equal because God created us, as it says back in Genesis, in His image and likeness. So therefore, we're all equal. And that's true. But the reality in our world is not that at all. There are many people that will judge you because of your socioeconomic status, because your GPA, your athletic prowess, or as we're going to be talking about for the next couple of weeks, your race, and in particular, the color of your skin. Now, I can honestly say that when I was growing up many years ago in the Bay Area, it wasn't an issue. You know, in both the public school and the Catholic schools that I went to, I had kids in my class who were Black, Chinese, Japanese. I had one kid I know, he was Korean. And we had a lot of Hispanics. And I, nor anyone that I was ever with in school, ever made any comments about that. You know, we all got along fine. We may have, like with any friends, preferred this one over that one. The one Black kid, he was a good ball player, so everybody always wanted him on their team. You know, the one Korean kid, he was not so good, so nobody wanted him on his team. It had nothing to do with his race; it had to do with his athletic abilities. But as I continued to grow up and moved yet to another school and back to the Midwest, yeah, I never really saw it as an issue. The only time we would see race as an issue is in the beginning of the 1960s, when they started building the big housing projects, because this was going to solve the problem. So what did the government do? We built huge high-rise buildings and put all the poor people, and I'll be honest, most of them were Black, into a single building. You know, so how are they going to get out of this? They probably aren't. So what happens next? Along comes this individual by the name of Martin Luther King, great gentleman. And because he was in the South and he knew they had a lot of the racial problems down there, he wanted to do something about it. And I think without a doubt anyone can say that Martin Luther King's key to his success was that it was always peaceful. Everything was nonviolent. Because he knew that the people who were against him were just looking for an excuse. And so he wasn't going to give them one. Everything they did was peaceful. And so I think that just made a huge difference. And again, fast forward a few years, I was now in the Marine Corps. Some of the best friends that I made in boot camp were Blacks. Fast forward a little further, I was in Vietnam. Again, surrounded with Blacks and Asians and every other color under the rainbow. Didn't really see any racial problems because everybody had a common goal. We had people that were trying to kill us and blow us up. So our goal was to get home in one piece. And so we didn't care what color the guy was next to us. We just wanted to make sure that he had our back and we had his back. Fast forward to today. I am not about to try and tell anyone or convince anyone that there isn't racism in our country. But I think one of the biggest problems that we have is that a lot of people don't want to talk about it. They want an instant cure. We live in an instant world. You know, how many of us today, it's like, how long is this microwave going to take? It seems like it's taking forever. So nothing is fast enough for us. We get mad at our computers or our phones because something isn't downloading quick enough. Well, we didn't get here overnight. We're not getting out overnight. We've made great strides since the 1960s. But are where we really want to be? No. Not by a long shot. But I think the thing we have to be careful of is we begin to confuse issues. You know, is it really racial inequality in some cases? Or is it just bad people? For example, when George Floyd was killed by that cop, was that right? No. It wouldn't matter what color George was. It's wrong. But because George was black, it was made a big issue. And one thing has led to another, and here we are. You can't go anywhere or do anything where the conversation isn't now about race and everything is unfair. You know, we've reached a point now where we're tearing down statues of virtually anybody and everybody for any reason or no reason at all. You know, we listen to one side of the story, for example, about Father Junipero Serra tearing down his statues, saying that he was, you know, imprisoned and incarcerated the Indians. And that's not true. Go back and look at the story. We say the same thing, you know, about all police. You know, are all police bad? No. But the bottom line is, it has to start with each one of us. You know, do you have a racial prejudice? And if so, why? You know, many of the racial prejudices we see today are fueled by others. There was a video out on YouTube or on Facebook, I think it was, not too long ago. It showed a little black boy and a little white boy, about 3 years old, running to each other. They were friends and they embraced and they were so happy together. And what did someone do? They took and they doctored the video to make it look like the little black boy was running away from the white boy because he was supposedly afraid. What was the reality? The reality was not that. The reality was that they were friends. But too many times we listen to other people and that's what forms our opinion. You know, if I ever had a negative experience with a person of another race, certainly. But how many experiences have I had with people of my own ethnic background, my own race? So I think we have to remember, you know, it's not about race. It's about people. And it's about their prejudices, justified or not. And the best way to, in my opinion, to end all of this is to stop looking at each other as black and white. You know, we have to start talking about it in terms of people. Was the man whose life was taken by that cop justified? No. Does it matter that he was black and the cop was white? What if it was reversed? What if he was white and the cop was black? Would everyone still be so upset? Hopefully so. And we have to stop looking at people as black and white and start looking at them as back in Genesis God said, a creation in His image and likeness. And that, you know, Jesus didn't come and die for the blacks or for the whites. He came and died for all of us. And it goes beyond just black and white. And so I think we need to look at our own prejudices and ask, you know, why we have them. Are they because of our experiences? or because of what other people have taught us. I have seen firsthand where young children, black and white, mixed together without a problem at all, until somebody begins to tell them that they're different and you can't be with that white person, or you can't be by that black person. You know, my wife grew up in the South for most of her years, and she can share some really sad stories about how the people were treated. Was it right? No. But this burning down stores and looting them fix the problem? No. We have to have a conversation. We have to come to see that we're not different because of our background, whether it's race, religion, or ethnicity. But we're all created and equal in the eyes of God. And until we can look at each other that way and begin to spread that word, just like we spread the word about Jesus, we're going to continue to have this problem. So with that, I will let you go. Hopefully we'll be able to get together soon and talk in person, because I don't know about you, but all these videos in Zoom are getting a little boring. God bless.
So that was Jim Abel, who has been one of our most amazing contributors at St. Bernard's, and he's been doing ministry for a long time. So that was his experience throughout his years, which it's different for each one of us. And let's just remember a couple of things. One, let's remember that there are brothers and sisters out there that feel that there's no compassion for them, that they feel outcast, and they don't feel welcome. I hope that none of you listening feel that way, because if you do, please know that we love you. If this was your first time joining, or is this your 1,000th time joining, please know that you are welcome and that you are loved. And when we talk about the body of Christ hurting, when one hurts, we all hurt. This is true. And I think of how God the Father, being our Father, is hurting as he sees some of his children feeling not only like outcasts, like they don't belong, but also as they see them fighting each other. Like, as a mother, when I see my children fight, it hurts me. I want them to get along. And that's what God wants. Even though there is a reality out there, maybe not in our community so much, maybe it is, maybe you've shared something or will share something where we can walk with you. But there are brothers and sisters that don't feel welcome, that don't feel accepted, that feel that somebody else is going to put them down and might be afraid to stepping up to doing something amazing because of that fear. So let's be that light, and let's allow the Lord to restore our hearts so we can be light for them. Also, let's remember that the Spirit came for all of us. You know, we celebrated Pentecost just a couple of weeks ago, and remember with the chicken wings, you know, the Bible verse that we read, it was like the Spirit came to all, and we all heard the same voice. We all understood what we were listening. And that is our prayer right now to the Spirit, to allow all of us that may not be listening to listen and to be able to hear one word, which is, the Lord is with us, and the Lord loves you and created you, yellow, blue, black, brown, whatever color we are. Like, for God, we are black and white. Like, we're like in a, there's no color for him. We all look exactly the same because we were all created in his image and likeness. And lastly, the Bible says in John 2:7-11, he who hates his brother is in the darkness. So if we feel, if I feel so righteous, or so holy, like some people make fun of me and call me, which is so not true. But if we feel so that we are on the other side, that we get God and we're good, but we are not at peace with one of our brothers and sisters, even if we don't know them, then we live in darkness. So let's remember this. Let's remember that being in the light, it's to love all of our brothers and sisters in Christ, even if we don't understand some of their points of view. That doesn't mean that we agree with some of the things that are happening, like Jim said. But we are to love them, crazy, crazy love them, and then just allow God to speak to our hearts, to do our part. And maybe our part is to like get on our knees and pray. Maybe our part is to speak truth or lovingly to someone. So let's just ask the Spirit to always be with us and to walk with us. Holy Spirit, we ask that you bless this time, and that you bless this country, Lord, that is so divided, and that is the enemy doing his work. But you are so powerful, and the powerful, you will again redeem our world. You will again set us free. You will again open our ears as your Spirit flies over our country. Please bring healing and love and understanding. And we pray for our community so we can be that light and we can unite ourselves in your name and not divide ourselves in a bunch of different opinions. You are almighty and are powerful, and we thank you, Lord, for giving us the strength to go on with this conversations. Bless all of our conversations that we will have in the future. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right. See you soon. Bye.